In the year 1950, two mysteries baffle the city of New York in the United States. The first involves an extraordinary number of reports of unknown objects flying through the country's skies. The second mystery is a series of unexplained and peculiar disappearances of garbage cans in the city. Yes, in 1950, New York faced an unprecedented outbreak of thefts of metal garbage cans. Cartoonist Alan Dunn devised a potential solution for both mysteries and presented it in the form of a comic strip in the New York Times. The explanation for UFO sightings and the disappearance of garbage cans was simple. UFOs were coming to Earth to steal trash bins. Alan Dunn's comic strip, although a joke, had a rather unexpected consequence. It sparked the modern debate on the possibility of extraterrestrial life. The newspaper with Dunn's comic strip reached the Los Alamos Nuclear Research Laboratory in New Mexico, where physicist Emil Konopinski showed the cartoon of aliens stealing trash cans to his colleague Enrico Fermi during lunch. Fermi, in a playful tone, remarked that Dunn's idea was an excellent scientific hypothesis because it explained two things at once. However, the joke initiated a serious discussion about the possibility of intelligent civilizations and interstellar travel. As is the case in good lunchtime conversations, the dialogue evolved into more earthly topics, unrelated to astronomy or extraterrestrial life. However, Fermi was a bit absent in this second part of the conversation. He thought silently until he interrupted the discussion with an exclamation that would become historic. "Where is everyone?" The other scientists soon realized that Fermi was not referring to the same subjects they were, but was continuing the conversation about extraterrestrial life. Fermi performed something he did very well: complicated numerical estimates. This type of exercise became known as Fermi estimation. Fermi's most famous estimate is the question, "How many piano tuners are there in Chicago?" Fermi used common sense and logical reasoning to deduce an approximate number, notable for getting close to the correct answer. Hence, this type of mental estimation was named after him. The question Fermi had just calculated in his mind was as follows: "How many intelligent civilizations exist in our galaxy?" His conclusion was that there should be so many civilizations that we should have observed some already, so the lingering question was, "Where is everyone?" This is Fermi's paradox. If Earth is a common planet, then the universe must be teeming with life. However, no matter where we look, we see no signs of life anywhere. It seems that the universe is exclusively ours. How do we reconcile these two facts? Fermi's paradox is one of the main approaches to discussing the possibility of extraterrestrial life. And it is interesting not because it lacks an answer, but because it has many answers, and each possible explanation makes sense in a different universe. A particularly intriguing consideration I want to explore in this video is the following. Are we the first, or one of the first civilizations to exist in our galaxy? At first glance, this answer may seem uncomfortable, as it seemingly places humanity in a special position in the history of the universe. However, it's inevitable that some civilization will be the first. So, does it make sense that we could be one of them? Initially, we're not sure, but we can examine different possible scenarios. Although the universe is old, around 13.7 billion years, its longevity is considerable, and stars like the Sun will continue to exist for tens of millions of years into the future. However, the Sun is among the stars that will have a shorter lifespan. There are other types of stars, such as red dwarfs, that will persist for trillions of years. The point is that the universe holds much more history for the future than it has experienced in the past. We are literally in the early stages of the universe. Depending on the necessary conditions for the emergence of intelligent life, we cannot rule out the real possibility of being one of the first civilizations in our galaxy, if not in the entire universe. And when I mention possibility, I'm using the term in the statistical sense because, based on some variables we'll examine shortly, it's likely that we are one of the first civilizations in the universe. Let's explore three possible scenarios. In the first, the origin of life is viable only in star systems similar to the Sun. This implies that life arises only on rocky planets orbiting Sun-like stars. Furthermore, the emergence of intelligent life takes billions of years. just as it happened on Earth. However, given the right conditions on a planet, it's likely that intelligent life will emerge at some point. All we need is enough time. This scenario is called the principle of mediocrity because it assumes that humanity is a perfectly average example of civilization. In other words, we're nothing special, but we inhabit a common planet orbiting a common star. We didn't become who we are for any exceptional reason beyond pure statistical probability, which, by the way, favored us. Even considering these conditions and this scenario, we are still in a relatively early stage in the history of the universe. In statistical terms, the most opportune moment for the existence of intelligent life in the universe is still to come, predicted to occur in approximately 15 billion years. This is the period when the Milky Way, our galaxy, will have the highest number of sun-like stars. In other words, most intelligent civilizations that the galaxy will host have not yet emerged, and many of the planets that will eventually give rise to intelligent life probably haven't even formed yet. In this sense, we're not in an extremely early stage. If there are 1,000 intelligent civilizations in total in our galaxy, considering past and future, there are currently 250 intelligent civilizations, including ours. Therefore, 75% of the civilizations that will arise in the Milky Way are yet to come. This is the principle of mediocrity scenario. What sets it apart from the other two scenarios is that it doesn't assume that sun-like stars are the most ideal type for life. This perspective makes sense, considering that the sun and similar stars will only be able to support life for about 6 or 7 billion years, which is practically half the current age of the universe. There are stars, like orange and red dwarfs, that will last much, much longer than the sun. If life is possible around these longer-lived stars, the scenario changes significantly, and the peak of habitability in the universe will only be reached in hundreds of billions of years. In that case, we would have emerged very early in the history of life in the universe, when the universe reaches its most populous period, with life thriving around almost every star. Any trace of humanity that existed at the beginning of the universe will have been erased forever. There are two distinct scenarios worth exploring here. Firstly, if the evolution of intelligent life is relatively easy, even around stars like the Sun, then we are among the first civilizations in the galaxy. If there are 1,000 civilizations in our galaxy, then we are indeed the first. If there are 10,000 civilizations, we are among the first 10. In other words, 99.9% of intelligent life that will exist in the universe has not yet emerged, representing a statistical loneliness. The second alternative is even lonelier. Perhaps life around stars like the Sun is an exception, and the emergence of intelligent life takes much longer than it did on Earth. Earth would be an exception, not a rule. And the true habitat for intelligent life would be red dwarfs, which remain habitable for a more extended period. If this is the reality, then not only are we the first in our galaxy, but we are probably the first civilization in the entire universe. This doesn't imply that life in the universe is unlikely or uncommon. It simply means that, currently, life in the universe is unlikely. We had the misfortune of inhabiting the universe while it is still too young for life. In this scenario, 1 trillion years are missing for the universe to reach the peak of its habitability. We arrive too early for the party. In other words, it is unlikely but not impossible that we are the first civilization in the universe. Some intelligent civilization will evidently need to be the first, and given that the universe is still far from its period of greatest habitability, 99.9% of intelligent civilizations that will arise probably haven't even formed their planets yet. The first civilizations will surely look at the sky and be puzzled by the silence they observe in every direction. Many of them will have their own names for the Fermi Paradox, and who knows what solutions they will find to explain the loneliness. The Fermi Paradox remains an open problem, and every day more questions and hypotheses emerge in an attempt to explain where everyone is. What about you? Were you convinced by the idea that we are the first, or at least among the first, in the universe? If not, which solution to the Fermi Paradox would you like to see in a video on this channel? Share your opinions in the comments. Thank you very much, and until next time.